Each time that I speak about diabetic retinopathy, I like to present this data. I don't know if you are aware of that. In April this year, was published the most important epidemiologic study never done in medicine. And to produce this, this paper, there was a collaboration among the most important epidemiologic centers in the world. The Imperial College School of Public Health, the WHO, the For Italy, the Istituto Superiore di Sanità, all the most important centers in the world were working together to produce this paper, the NCD Risk Factor Collaboration. So this paper took into consideration 751 population-based studies. So a huge amount of studies. And they considered a period of time between 1980 and 2014. So 34 years. And 4.4 million of subjects were considered. So something incredible in 146 different countries. So we cannot make a comment on each single results of the study. I don't want to bother you, but I'd like to stress some data coming out from this study. The number of patients affected by diabetes mellitus during these 34 years was more than four times. So from 108 million, we are now to 422 million. The male, the diabetic males, went from 4.3 to 9, diabetic female from 5 to 7.9. But the most important point is this sentence. The author said, following this trend, diabetic patients will be 700 million in 2025, and this is the most important point. The health system will collapse wherever. We will not be able to face this problem. But although this data, we are doing nothing. I don't know here, but in my country, we are doing nothing. And we will be destroyed by diabetes because we will not have money for doing anything else than treating patients with diabetes, which is incredible. So what is the solution? I think there is no solution, but we should try to implement screening program for complications. We need to make some kind of educational program. We should try to do some kind of primary prevention or secondary prevention, but we should modify our approach, otherwise the disease will destroy us. They will win. Diabetes will win against us. So please, if you can, try to be proactive. Try to talk to your politicians. Try to talk to your administrators. And try to modify the approach. We cannot follow diabetes. We need to be first and try to avoid diabetes. Okay, this is important. All over is important. And here you have some data. With reference to the reason why this is happening, it's probably the higher urbanization, the people is wherever, becoming older and older because the quality of medicine is improving. The lifestyle is changing wherever, and this is also a reason for some kind of increasing the number of diabetic patients. And then also the diet, which is changing. It's changing mainly in countries where the genetics is not craving for a different kind of diet. If you think to Africa or some other poor area of the world where McDonald's is arriving and people are starting to eat McDonald's way, for sure the genetics of those patients is not ready for that. And you have obesity, you have diabetes. Any comment on that? How is the situation in your country? Is diabetes increasing a lot? Yes? So this is the geography of diabetes mellitus. The higher frequency is in country with medium low income. So the Pacific Islands, Middle East countries, North Africa countries. If you think about Polynesia or Polynesian, you have 20% of the population with diabetes. So numbers that are really incredible. On the same time, we had some paper published in diabetes care this year concerning not diabetes but diabetic retinopathy. And it was done with a similar method, meta-analysis of 14 countries. Of all the studies available in the epidemiology of diabetic retinopathy, 14 countries were considered in a period of time from 1990 to 2022, so 22 years in this case, not 34 as in the other. The number of people with vision impairment due to diabetic retinopathy has had an increasing proportion of all cases of blindness and moderate to severe visual impairment. So again, diabetes is exploding, and at the same time, diabetic retinopathy is increasing. Logical consequence of that. And here you have the number of people with blindness from diabetes in 2010, and this is the number of people with visual impairment. And there was an increase of blindness of 27% and 64% with reference to visual impairment. So all the data are in the same direction. And here you have that blindness from diabetic retinopathy is 2% in Southeast of Asia and Oceania, and this is 5.5% in Southern America. So again, all these data are similar. All these data tell us that we are living a dramatic phase in this increase of diabetes and diabetic. So, to remember this data, it's important to make something. Each one of us must do something for trying to face this dramatic epidemic problem. So, as you know very well, diabetic macular edema was classified on the basis of a concept which was introduced by Gary Friedman in diabetic retinopathy study. The concept is clinically significant macular edema and not clinically significant macular edema. It was a very pragmatic way of thinking of our US colleagues, and they tried to separate these two different populations. When edema is involved in the fovea, it's a clinically significant macular edema. If fovea is not involved, it is not clinically significant. Okay? This is known, I think, by all of you. This kind of approach to the problem of diabetic macular edema was acceptable when we had only laser for treating our patients. Because in that case, you had to do laser in order to limit the damage to the most central part of the retina. No? So in order to limit the damage, you had to do laser, which was the only way of treating our patients. At the moment, this is not the reality, because we can do other kind of therapies. We can do laser. Usually, it is done in a different way from what we did before. You remember maybe that in the manual of operation of early treatment diabetic retinopathy study, it was written down that laser had to be done producing a wide effect on the retina. The macular area, you had to make all the red regions becoming white. So it means that you had to use a lot of energy. You had to destroy the region. And at the moment, this approach is not acceptable. This is not what we do today. Today, we consider that the best approach is to produce some light effect on the retina or some threshold effect, but anyway, something which is able to spare the retina much more than before. Anyway, laser is still there. It's not dead. Okay? And then we have these other solutions. We have the anti-VEGF approach, as you know very well, no? Which is the most common approach today. We have this Theron's approach, but we have also vitrectomy for cases when you think that there is some kind of role for tractional damage to the retinal tissue. And finally, you can combine different approaches in order to improve your therapeutic effect. So if you have all these different approaches, you cannot think as we did before that macular edema can be separated in two very simple forms, clinically significant and not clinically significant on the basis of the central involvement. This is not enough, because otherwise you will not be able to treat with the best approach each single patient. Did you get the idea? Yeah? Sure? So if you have only one therapeutic approach, it's enough to say, okay, the center is involved, I must spare the macula, I do laser. That's the only way to treat. Or the macula is not involved, I don't treat the patient. But if you have many different potential approaches, you need to understand, or at least to try to understand, which is the best approach for that specific. This is the rationale. Do you agree with that?
Yes.
Okay. This is my way of thinking. And that's the reason why we try to propose this one. This is, I do not want to convince you that this is the best approach, but I like to convince you that we need to move in this direction. We need to separate the form of vasogenic edema where you can see well the microaneurysms, the anomalies responsible for edema, usually associated with heart accidents. And these patients can be well treated with laser. Very light laser on the microvascular abnormalities can have some therapeutic effect which stay for a long time. If you don't see the relationship between the anomalies and the edema, for sure you cannot do laser. There is no reason to do laser. It's much better to do injections. You can do injections also in these pathogenic cases, but there is some rationale to start with laser. You agree? And then, for sure, if you have some kind of tractional edema, you need to try to eliminate the tractional component. So you can discuss that. You can say, no, I don't think so. I need to include some other group or some subset of patients. For some reason, I do not want to repeat to convince you that this is the best approach, but this is my approach. And what I like to underline is that this approach is taking into account the reason for edema in that specific patient. If you take into account the reason for edema, you can hope to do the best treatment for each single patient. And you can try to do your treatment which is tailored on the patient need. Yeah. Can I have the microphone from?
So you mean by vasogenic edema that you're detecting vessel around the
unfortunately, I tried to have this presentation not so long, and I did not have here the image. But I tried to describe you what I intend for vasogenic edema. Vasogenic edema is an edema where you are able to see a group of microvascular abnormalities which are centering a circular area of edema, of thickness of the retina, usually at the border, at the edge of this circular area, you can see heart accidents. So you have your circinate maculopathy, and you have the retina which is thicker in that area, and then you have in the center microvascular abnormalities. If you do fluorescein angiography, you see very well a very early injection of these microvascular abnormalities, so you have hyperfluorescence. And in the late phase angiograms, you have leakage from those microvascular abnormalities. So early injection and late leakage.
So you see cincinnate.
Cincinnate usually is present at the border of this area, which has this circular shape centered by microvascular abnormalities.
Microvascular abnormalities, you see some rest?
Microvascular abnormalities, I mean microanomalies and other kind of anomalies of these moments.
Irmas
or microanomalies. Is that clear for everybody? Do you have in mind what I'm speaking about? A patient with a typical pattern of cincinnate, microvascular abnormality in the center, cincinnate exudates around there. Usually the shape is circular, and they can be more or less near the center of the fovea, they can be far away from there, but the concept is there. Okay, so if you see a patient like that, you can try to have a therapeutic effect by laser, very light laser. You can treat them in the center, and you can see after some months that the thickness is reduced and the exudates disappear. And the advantage is that you can do that with a low-cost treatment, which is taken for a long time. I am still seeing patients living 20 years ago, 25 years ago, they don't need anything more. And what you did many years ago is still effective for preventing the advanced stages of the disease. Any question more? Please. Usually you have, I repeat, you have early injection of the dye and leakage in the late phase angiograms. You say the brain is becoming hard. The heart doesn't start. So it's clear what is this at the moment. This is when you don't see this relationship, this cause-effect relationship between some anomaly of vessels and increased thickness of the retina. When you don't see that, it is not vasogenic. You don't see any vascular anomaly responsible for that you're seeing, okay? This is non-vasogenic edema. And diffractional edema is whatever you can imagine, because you have a hyaloid which is thick, which is maybe some flexion and whatever. Okay? So in these cases, you do your laser before, then if you don't have any response, you do anti-VEGF steroids. If you have a response, you can monitor your patients, you don't need to do more. when you don't have any anomaly that you can treat by laser, you need to make your injections. You can do a IVGF, you can do steroids on the basis of your ideas or your clinical evaluations. And when you have a fracture, you need to make surgery. So another thing that was is becoming evident today is that diabetic retinopathy is not only vascular problem. When I was young and I was taught about diabetic retinopathy, the only pathogenic concept was you have a vascular capillaropathy. You have a capillaropathy produced by diabetes, by increased glycemia. No? And this was the way that we were taught years ago. And today we know that this is not all the story. There is also something more. The inflammatory component of diabetic retinopathy and of diabetes, generally speaking, is becoming more and more important. Sometimes you have the feeling that this is a bit of fashion. Medicine many times has different phases. It's something which is becoming a fashion. At the moment, you have a bit of feeling that there is some fashion around there. But for sure, some inflammatory component is considered today important for interpreting what is happening in diabetic retinopathy. And again, degeneration of the neural component of the retina is another aspect of the pathogenic mechanism. So it is not so easy. You cannot treat your patients only considering vessels, but you need to consider also the other component of the pathogenic mechanism. With reference to the inflammatory component, you know that there is already evidence, and it was already shown that all these cytokines are increased during diabetic retinopathy. So it is not only words. I mean, this is already a lot of evidence that the inflammatory component of diabetic retinopathy is important. It was shown already. And here you have one of the papers where it was shown that you have interleukin 6, 8, and so on that are significantly higher in patients with DMO, which means diabetic macular edema, compared with normal subjects, as you can see here, or compared with the branch lateral vein occlusion. So, a lot of evidences that the inflammatory component of diabetic retinopathy is not only the history. Way of thinking. It's something concrete. And you know, the inflammatory cytokines produce endothelial tight junction loss, leukostasis, endothelial and pericytic cell loss, and as a consequence of that, you have this chronic inflammation, low level inflammation, which is important for determining. One of the aspects important is this role of microglial cells. And normally, these cells result activated by the condition of hyperglycemia. They become responsible of part of the pathogenic mechanism of the disease. Here you have the synthesis, I mean, the summary of what I'm speaking about, where you see that these cells are moving down and they become responsible for many of these aspects. And they are important because they are mediators for vascular endothelial factor as well as other cytokines. Here you have a beautiful image from Kunyavash, from Beat Cohen and Josef Kunyavash, where you see that in diabetic retina, you have this activation of the microglial cells. Not only this, so you have not only this kind of evidence, experimental evidence, but you start to have also clinical evidence of the role of inflammation. This kind of hyperinflective foci that you can see in the OCT images are considered at the moment the most important areas that release this inflammatory component in the pathogenic mechanism. Are you familiar with this hyperinfective site?
Yes. Is it safe?
But not only microglia, also macroglia is important. And now we have evidence that these neural cells are very important. They are important for regulating the amount of water inside the retina. They are important for producing vascular endothelial growth factor and other cytokines. So there are all of these cells that when I was studying the retina, they were considered the structure, but they were not considered important for the pathogenesis of different diseases. Today, a lot of information are coming out with the evidence that these cells are important in determining the pathogenic mechanism of So, what to do? What I was saying before, we cannot do always the same things, because different patients are different from the others. So my ideal way of treating should be to identify different subset of patients, different subset of edema, for different kinds of treatments. This should be our aim. And maybe we as eye doctors, we are not good enough to work in this direction. We were not able to produce new way of classifying our patients, helping us to decide which is the best treatment for each single patient. Is there someone from the company at the moment? Are you from the company?
No.
Because I like to say something very bad with the, for the companies. Because if we do not do that as eye doctors, the company will never do something like that. Because the companies would like to have trials for registration of the drugs that are not indicating subset of patients. They would like to have trials showing that that drug is able to improve everyone. Because on the basis of that result, they can ask for registration and reimbursement for any patient. So it's not their interest to say, okay, vasogenic edema, you must be treated this way, non-vasogenic in this way, and so on. They would like to have a broad indication for their drug. That's obvious. But as a consequence of that, we have the problem to identify the best patient for each single treatment. And the history of these last years is ending. We are now working to identify the best patient for the best treatment, the best algorithm of treatments for our patients. Why? Because they did a study with the monthly injections for 24 months, knowing well that it is impossible to do it in clinical practice, but did that. Why? In order to have registration, because the drug in that way works at the highest level, and although they know that it is not useful for us because it's impossible to do monthly treatment for everybody for all lifelong, which is crazy, we have different interests. So we need to work for ourselves, for our patients. So it's important to have the data coming from the companies, but we need to use them for our clinical practice, and we need to find the best way to use the drugs. Any idea about that? Do you have different ideas about that? Anyone from the company? No? Mr. Novartis is there?
Yes.
Mr. Bell? Okay. I hope I was able to explain myself. So, you know, the steroids, triamcinolone was the first to be used with a lot of complications. Then we had dexamethasone, Ontotex, and then today we have also Ilugen, which is coming out with more side effects than the others. So they, you came in now, right now, right? Mr. Novartis.
Yes.
I am very lucky. I was saying something bad about the companies. I was saying that, no, I'm explaining you. I was saying that the interest of the companies is to make studies, registered studies, where you're able to show that all the patients can be treated with that drug with good results. That's your interest for sure. So you are not interested to make some classification, very precise classification of patients in order to have different subsets, the one more sensitive and the other less sensitive. This is not our interest. Our interest is to identify different subgroup of patients and to address different patients with different treatments. Can you bring the microphone? You work with us to identify the best subgroup of patients. But first, your interest is to have a broad indication for the drug. Okay. The BEAT trial was a trial used by Allergan to show that the Autotex was effective for diabetic macular edema. And here you have the main result of the trial where you see that the drug was able to produce some kind of positive effect on diabetic macular edema. As you know, there is some kind of specific indication for patients affected by cataract and diabetes for using this kind of approach, because the use of steroids in patients that are going to be treated by cataract extraction is able to produce some protective effect in order to avoid development of diabetic macular edema or worsening of diabetic macular edema, because in diabetic patients, the event of the Irving gas syndrome is higher than in the other. So the combination of the steroidal approach together with the surgery can be able to slow down the numbers. For sure, also, anti-VEGF can be used in the same direction for the same glucose, and you can do your injection on the same type of surgery. I'm used to combine to do cataract surgery, and at the end of surgery, I do one stitch and I inject anti-VEGF and or steroids. The advantage of anti-VEGF is that you do not have the theoretical risk of reducing the capability of the eye to respond to an infection. If you have some kind of infection during surgery and you injecting steroids, potentially you are producing a very high risk situation for the patient. This is not the case for anti-VEGF. Are you using to combine, injections and cataract surgery in your diabetic patients whenever you have diabetic macular edema or other kind of diabetic complications?
Combination.
You can leave the microphone here. It's really the lesson to you.
Why do you want to use combination?
Whenever you have diabetic macular edema in a patient with cataract,
and but you have to treat the diabetic macular edema before.
Before, sure, if you can.
I thought you said.
But if you have a cataract and you cannot do it as you want, because you cannot do laser, you don't see well what is going on there, you see that there is edema, but you are not able to evaluate it very well. The combination of injection and scalp surgery is able to slow down the risk of having a huge worsening of diabetic macular edema, as you can have
after doing the
procedure after cataract surgery. Now, that's what I do, and I do since a lot, right? Any other experience? Yes. serving diabetic macular edema and cataract surgery.
Before cataract, I would give you that
steroid. Steroid. You prefer steroid?
Non-steroid and eye drops.
Okay, eye drops for sure.
Yes.
But if we are more than eye drops.
No, I would do injection, but not combination.
So you do before or after?
No, before.
Before?
And during. But not combination at the same time with the cataract.
Stop working.
Not with the cataract surgery combination. I would get non-steroid and pre-op, continue it after surgery, do my cataract surgery, and do one of them, either steroid or anti-injection.
Mm-hmm.
Either, but both.
In order to make the procedure easier for the patient, and you don't need to bring the patient again for injections.
Because if you use a steroid, it would be an anti-VEGF by itself. It has an anti-VEGF effect by itself. I don't see the reason behind using another anti-VEGF along with the steroid during the
treatment. No. I'm not saying that I inject both. I'm saying that I do have surgery and anti-VEGF or steroids. Okay, if you don't have any other comments, we can go ahead. And for sure, steroids are associated with side effects, as you know they were. These are the ones described by the David Boyer in the Ring trial. And you see that when you do injections of Ozurdex, you can have development of cataract in a high percentage of cases and increase of intraocular pressure. In my experience, when you do 2-3 injections of Ozurdex, cataract is always better. You cannot avoid that. It's not a drama, but if you can avoid it, it's better for sure. Mainly in young patients. And this is the other study that was done using fluocinolone, FAME trial. I don't know if you are familiar with that. In this case, fluocinolone was used in this specific group of eyes with very chronic diabetic macular edema, very aggressive form. People already treated with laser, with a bad vision acuity, and the involvement of the center of the retina. So they were very bad patients. They were treated with this implant of fluocinolone, and the results were good because, as you see, the improvement was maintained for 3 years. So apparently, this could be a very good option because 3 years of efficacy means that you do not need to have these procedures repeating many times for years. You, with one injection, you could be able to produce the results. Unfortunately, as always, the coin has two faces. And in this case, the other face of the coin is that you have a lot of side effects, and the rate of cataract extraction was 80%. The need for your medication, lowering medication, was 38.4% and 5% of surgeries for intraocular pressure increase. The company says that these data are not corresponding to clinical practice because they say that in clinical practice they have less rate of side effects. I am not able to give you my personal experience. I'm not using fluocinolone. Is not available in my country at the moment. It is available in Great Britain, it's available in Germany, and in some other European countries, but not in Italy. And I think in the next months we will have registration for, at least the drug was already registered, but we will have reimbursement for the drug in the next future. And after that, maybe we will be able to give you, I will be able to give you some personal experience. But at the moment, if you want to make a balance of this fluocinolone implant, it has this important advantage of a very long efficacy associated with higher rate of complications. And then the anti-VEGF drugs. For sure, these are the most common way of treating our patients to get it for the basic macular edema. You know, the rate of complications is pretty very low. We feel that this is a very safe approach to our patients, and we, I think that everyone is has similar experiences. Who is using the anti-VEGF approach for the diabetic macular edema today? And the others are doing something different, or you are not treating? No, I'm serious now.
Laser.
What do you do, laser?
Yes.
Who is doing laser as first approach for diabetic patients? Nobody. Who is using steroid as first approach for diabetic macular edema? One only. Do you know that there is some Novartis person in the room?
Yes.
She doesn't know. But you cannot know who she is. Okay, but anyway, although that I must say one thing about this problem, I'm serious now. I'm anyway thinking that the rate of complication that we have from anti-VEGF approach is higher than what we think. And my personal experience is that months ago, I was calling a neurologist of my hospital, asking for a patient that I was treating with anti-VEGF and who was treated by them also because he had a vascular problem, important vascular problem. And I was asking her, how is he, or why do you think that is happening, and so on. And she told me, but Francesco, this is normal. It's we see a lot of your patients that develop. This is not rare. I mean, something which is happening. And I do not know how much is high this rate of complications, but I think this is higher than what we think, because nobody is saying that, nobody has the interest to say that. We as eye doctors, we do not want to stress that our patients can have some complications from our treatment. And nobody is really describing the real rate of complication. Mr. Novartis, do you have an idea about that? We have some kind of different way of seeing the problem from your perspective? Can you bring the microphone to the man there? Was we as eye doctors usually do not say anything about complications of our patients because there is no interest in that. We are not interested to be serious in describing all the side effects produced as a consequence of our treatment, for the obvious reason that we do not want to be inside the problem. And I have the feeling that the number of patients with some complication is higher than what we think. So I'm asking you if from your perspective, you have a different feeling. You have the feeling that something is happening in this area.
From the company, obviously, we have adverse events hotlines where doctors are supposed to report all adverse events that come from drugs, but I think that it's safe to say that underreporting.
Is there anybody who had some complication from anti-VEGF? And did you say that officially or not? Do you have a system in your country, no?
Yes, we do. Yes.
Did you do that or not?
Yes, sir.
You did?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. I had some personal patients, but mostly were with Vivas to be the devil step. They were more related to Vivas system. Maybe, because when I worked, we used more Vivas system. At the military hospital. I don't know.
You are from Lebanon?
Yes,
Devas.
So we have a huge amount of patients that we treat weekly. And I have a feeling that it was happening more, it was related to work with more with Vivas system. Even on that, I knew about it because it was.
So you were able to make a strict relationship between.
Yes, but we went blind like this in 1 hour. If we let alone with the system, then we'll go with the financial burden. We have to go to Renda Pizuma, Athia, it would be more and more. I had one patient yesterday, after 1 week, one patient I had with a cardiovascular accident, stroke.
Me too, I had.
Yes. I had a feeling that it helped me. They used more than the system.
Usually it depends from the region where you are.
There is some region where your patients that the neurologist refer to. When
no, medical we use only labeled drug.
Oh.
Only radiofizumab or Eylea. We don't use okay. The bevacizumab okay. In Lombardia, okay. Which is one of the regional okay. Regions. Okay. It's the more popular region, but you have some other region where bevacizumab is widely used. But for example, me too, I was still in another university at the time in Udine, and I did not see a patient that was planned to be treated the day. I was treating him, it was a dramatic patient with a lot of complications and a very, very advanced diabetic retinopathy. And I called the family, my nurse called the family asking for the patient, why he's not here today? And he died 1 week ago. And I didn't say anything. Also in that case, in that case, I'm sure there was a relationship between the use of the drug and the vascular system, not vascular complication. Okay, but in conclusion, I must say anyway that myself as an eye doctor, I feel really comfortable when I treat my patients with optic gel. I use a lot the drugs. I treat thousands of patients a year, and I never had the feeling that I had to move from optic gel to some other drug.
See, I don't want to be the devil's advocate, but using anti-VEGF has revolutionized the way we approach our patients. Can you imagine right now, if we didn't have that drug, how many unfortunate patients would go blind? Although I understand that anti-VEGF has some element of complication, and maybe the companies, yes, they don't want to tell you the whole story because they're convinced that it is for their benefit or for the patient's benefit. But I think it's between me and my patient, the trust has increased. After using anti-VEGF. I mean, I cannot rely totally right now, let's say, on laser and steroids. It is true that some will be beneficial, but I still believe that it's an important argumentarium in our treatment approach for patients, in the majority, I would say.
Yeah, I must say that this is for sure, this is true. But this is not all the story, because I'm sure that a large part of responsibility in this reduction of visual impairment from diabetic retinopathy is also related to the quality of metabolic control.
And early detection.
Early detection and metabolic control. I do not see and I do not treat the same number of advanced proliferative diabetic retinopathy that I treated when I was young. The number is really reduced today, at least in my country. The number of proliferative retinopathy is low now. The major part of diabetic complication is diabetic macular edema. And this is not because we are better. This is because the quality of metabolic control improved a lot, I'm sure. The number of patients with glycosylated hemoglobin of 12 or 13 that we had before today is really low. You have only two patients with this kind of very bad control of diabetes. I don't know your countries, but my country, this is really a huge change, important change. You don't have similar experiences? No? Yes or no? Who is the agreement with me? Nobody. So really, everyone is having different experiences. So you have still the same amount of diabetic patients with the advanced form of the diabetic retinopathy?
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah, but it's still the same. I mean, in rural areas, are they treated in the same way? You are treating them in your...
Generally speaking, it's improved, no question.
Across all of them?
Absolutely.
Even in the south?
Yeah.
Is this it?
Absolutely. The number of patients coming in my department for treatment is really going down.
It has to be a health reform. That's a major health reform.
That's
a decision from the government, the Italian government, to improve the quality of life.
Of the Centri Antidiabetici, which means the centers for diabetic complications that were introduced in Italy in the 60s, 70s.
Oh.
And we had a large number of centers distributed all around the country. And they were able to modify significantly the quality of metabolic control.
So
now we are closing that because we have no money.
Well,
fortunately.
Congratulations. That's very important. But this tells me right now the trend to use anti-VEGF, isn't it? The trend to use anti-VEGF is decreasing.
No,
did that affect it?
No, because we are treating a lot of patients anyway. But the number of patients with a significant visual impairment secondary to diabetic retinopathy is reduced. So this is the RCR net, as you probably know. This is the study that was done sponsored by the National Eye Institute. So this is an independent trial where the US colleagues compared three different groups of eyes. Patients treated with ranibizumab 0.3, this is important to be underlined, and bevacizumab and aflibercept. And they tried to see which one of these drugs was inferior to the others, which was able to produce the best results. And as you can see here, after 1 year, there was a difference. It seemed that aflibercept was the best, mainly when you consider patients with lower visual acuity, so patients with the most advanced forms of diabetic macular edema. But after 1 year, the results were not so different. You see here that aflibercept and ranibizumab produce similar results. The difference is always with the bevacizumab, which is showing less effect compared with the two labeled drugs. But what we need to underline is that this study was done in the United States using the dosage of the drug that is labeled in the United States for diabetic macular edema, which is 0.3 milligram. I don't know here how is the percentage. Do you know here? 0.3 or 0.5?
That's 0.5 everywhere in the world except the US.
Only US was.
Only US country.
So we must underline also for your countries that the drug was different from what we use. We use 0.5, which is more or less the double compared with 0.3 that we are using in medicine. state. So these results cannot be translated to our clinical reality because of that. And nobody can say how is the results if you use 0.5 instead of 0.3. But what we must underline is that after 2 years, the difference is not significant. They are overlapping one to each other. And the dosage that we use in our country is different from what was used in this study. So, in conclusion, the anti-VEGF approach using one or the other of the two labeled drugs does not produce significant differences. And it's always very effective. Any comment on that? What is important to say is that this study was done, again, considering not the pathogenic mechanism of edema. So you have more than 2 lines of visual acuity gained, 12 letters, 13 letters, means that you are nearby 3 lines of visual acuity gained. Maybe that these 13 letters could become 16 or 17 if you treat only patients with a certain kind of filter. If we were able to choose the best patient for the anti-VEGF, maybe this percentage, these values could be higher. On the basis of the concept that I tried to explain before. Okay? Because here, inside this group of patients, you have also patients that probably, on the basis of some clinical judgment, some clinical specific evaluation, you could not address to anti-VEGF, and you could choose some other treatment, laser or steroid, for that specific patient. And in that case, this percentage would be better. And in fact, looking at the other results of other studies, you have that 30%, 30 to 40% of the eyes treated with the anti-VEGF do not show a very good efficacy. So if you imagine that you enucleate this 30% of eyes not well responsive to anti-VEGF approach, you can enucleate them from these results, you could have maybe 17, 18 letters of gain. Don't you agree?
Yes.
So really, we have to make an effort in the direction of producing some classification system which is able to identify the best patient for anti-VEGF, steroid, laser, and so on. Okay, these are always the same results. These are the results of the DRCR-NET. Maybe I'm becoming too long now. Already 1 hour? Yeah? This is another point that must be underlined. When we do an injection of anti-VEGF for diabetic macular edema, we have the advantage of producing also a downgrade of the level of diabetic. And it was shown that when you do inside these trials that were done for diabetic macular edema, looking at the level of diabetic retinopathy, the injected eyes showed a downgrade of retinopathy. So you can really imagine that your treatment is able to improve the clinical, the general clinical situation of the patient, not only the diabetic macular edema. And here you have. We were speaking about the role of this Optos fundus camera in California system, where you can see better than what we can see normally the retinal ischemia in the periphery. And you can identify this retinal ischemia, and this can be correlated with the diabetic macular edema level. The concept is that when you have ischemia in the periphery, peripheral area are producing vascular endothelial growth factor, and this same vascular endothelial growth factor produces in increasing damage to other RDP. So the concept is, whenever you have this area of ischemia in the periphery, it's better to destroy these areas in order to have less vascular endothelial growth factor inside the eye, and therefore less damage in the macular edema. The paradox is that this concept is the opposite compared with what was told to me when I was a young doctor. In the diabetic retinopathy study, in the early treatment diabetic retinopathy study, it was written black or white that the treatment of the periphery, so the pan-retinal photoregulation, produced an increase in diabetic macular edema. And it was written down that before starting with the pan-retinal photoregulation, you had to treat your diabetic macular edema. It was obvious, because when you do your laser, you produce an inflammation of the eye, and inflammation of the eye means diabetic macular edema. If we ask, is an inflammation of the eye, no? So it was very clear that the concept that we are having today, that you need to treat the ischemia in order to reduce the level of vascular endothelial factor, and therefore to reduce diabetic macular edema, is apparently is the opposite concept compared with the other. So where is the truth? I don't know that. But this is again a fashion, you know, basically it's going different direction in different time. So this is again the use of the peripheral retina to classify the retinal macular edema. So you have three different categories. This is a paper published in this journal this year. And you have the form, which is microaneurysm driven, and this is what we described before as vasogenic edema. Then you have the peripheral ischemia, 37%, and the vascularization. You have a good response to anti-VEGF approach in all the three different kinds of edema, but you don't have a visual acuity improvement when you have reversals. Okay? This is an important information, it's useful information. And another new concept is this concept of disorganization of the retinal inner layers of the retina as a predictor for visual acuity evolution in these patients. And this is a contribution from the group of Paul Yellow. And this dream lesion, which means the lesion located at the level of the inner retina, not the outer retina. And when you have this kind of disorganization of the inner retinal layer, they are a very bad prognostic error. So the disorganization of retinal inner layers is a novel positive biomarker for bad evolution. Again, I like to remember you this algorithm. I try to convince you, and you are trying to get to me. So, that's my way of thinking. If you have to choose what to do, anti-VEGF as the first line, when you have no cardiovascular disease, clear lens, patient with uncontrolled glaucoma, patient compliance can attend for sure patients that can come frequently. Dexamethasone, when you have recent cardiovascular events, so you have some kind of contraindication for the anti-VEGF, or vitrectomized eyes, where the anti-VEGF unfortunately cannot stay enough inside the eye. And when you can imagine that the compliance is not good, and in stenophytic patients, which are the best indication for this kind of approach. Fluocinolone, which is only for patients with some kind of different response. They cannot do injections. They are really difficult patients. In these cases, can be fluocinolone can be useful. So, an upload study, Allen was working on this kind of algorithm, trying to identify, looking also at the systemic characteristic of the patient, trying to identify the best solution for each single patient. So I'd like to conclude saying that diabetic macular edema is a complex disease with a lot of manifestations. Advanced in retinal imaging, also in this case, can improve significantly our the efficacy of our treatment. And the comprehensive approach should match with any specific manifestation of diabetic retinopathy. And a tailored treatment, I think, is the solution for our patients in the future. Thank you very much. Any question? When you do your anti-VEGF or your steroids and you have a significant reduction of the thickness and a significant reduction of the blood retinal barrier breakdown, diffuse breakdown, you can start to recognize some specific area where the leakage is more evident. In that case, as a second line treatment after or steroids, you are in a condition to do your laser treatment targeting a single microvascular anomalies. But this is only a second line treatment after that you had obtained this reduction of the blood pressure of the data.
And in your experience, how long should we wait before the reduction of the thickness happens in your experience?
Your question is more complicated than that. Nobody knows how much you must wait, how many injections you must perform before concluding that the patient has no sensitivity to that specific drug. And in reference to that, this is another topic, the AMD, Novartis has in their files in Malina and Dunbar patients that were monthly treated and after 8 months started to show a significant improvement. Which means that you can never know when the sensitivity to the drug is starting to be evident. And theoretically, you are not allowed to say nothing before a very long period of time that you injected your patient. We assume that after 4, 5, 6 injections, you can say, okay, this patient is not sensitive. But I think this is not true in 100% of the cases. Sometimes you need more. I don't know why. Because theoretically, after each 30 days, you have nothing inside the eye. So each time you are doing it this way, you do not have some drug inside the eye that can do some additive effect in the next injection, theoretically. So you should not have this, but this happens. So why are we wrong? Any other question? From the company?
Everything you have in my library.
Nothing more? Do you want to go ahead? At what time we should close with my last